1889, a boy of 14 came here to one of the great mountains of his native Switzerland. It was a moment of revelation which stayed with him all his life. He saw in these mountains and valleys an image of the heights to which the human spirit could aspire and the depths through which it had to travel in order to fulfill its greatest purposes. It was a moment in which he felt outside time and space. The scene for him was like a reflection in a mirror of the immense hidden world within modern man. An intimation of a future in which he was to become one of the greatest explorers of the neglected human soul. An explorer of a world where the mind has mountains, cliffs of fall, frightful, sheer, no man fathomed. His name was Carl Gustav Jung. In 1959, 2 years before his death, he spoke to John Freeman of the BBC about his life. He was one of the great pioneers of modern psychiatry. Introvert, extrovert, archetypes, complex. These words we owe to Jung. But for years he was dismissed by many as a mystic. Today there's a growing realization that his work could help to reconcile science and religion, which for centuries have so disastrously divided the spirit of man against itself.
What sort of religious upbringing did your father give you?
Oh, we were Swiss Reformed.
And did he make you attend church regularly?
Oh, well, that was quite natural. Yes. Everybody went to church on Sunday.
And did you believe in God?
Oh, yes.
Do you now believe in God?
Now? Difficult to answer. I know. I don't need to believe. I know.
I never talk about Jung without wishing that I could present him alive to people as well, because he was such a wonderful advertisement for his own psychology and his own attitude to life. I met him, unfortunately, not nearly soon enough. He was just over 70 when he came into my life. I think I was still home the first time at Zurich. And I was one of the many people who had despised the thought of Jung. I'd never read him, but I myself had dismissed him as a mystic and a woolly sort of man. And anyway, I was so bored with the whole of Freud's concept of psychology and thought that Jung himself might be tainted with it, that in spite of the urgings of my wife, like ignoring my own feminine self, I rejected Jung. And when I met him, the moment I met him, I realized what a bloody fool I'd been. Jung spent his early childhood by the Rhine Falls at Laufen on Switzerland's frontier with Germany. The river nourished the feeling for water with which he seems to have been born. Without water, I thought, nobody could live at all. He also remembers lying in his pram in the shadow of a tree and the sense of indescribable well-being as he saw the sun glittering through the leaves. Everything is wholly wonderful, colorful, and splendid, he felt. Almost as naturally, he went on to experience his first great dream. He's not absolutely certain of the date, but somewhere between his third and his fourth year, he dreamt that he was presented with a dark, narrow opening in the earth which he had to enter, and had a pagan vision of reality, a pagan vision of the ultimate values. He saw in an inner chamber, enthroned on a golden throne, a phallic symbol with an eye in it. And this dream so haunted him that whenever afterwards he heard the name of Christ or God in the Christian sense, this dream automatically came to his mind. And yet it became one of the great unmentionables of his existence. And not until the age of 65 was he able to speak about this dream to others. By then he had recognized the image of the phallus as one of the basic mythological symbols of the divinity. And this dream as evidence of what he came to call the collective unconscious, that area of the mind where the experience of life outside time and space unfolds. This inner world of dreams became as real to Jung as the world of nature without. His home, he says, was no mere locality on the map, but truly God's world, filled with secret meaning. His father was vicar of the church at Laufen. One of the most touching things about Jung, the lonely, solitary child, was that at an early age he used to come into the garden of his parents and sit on a stone like this by the Rhine. It was almost his first meaningful relationship with something outside himself. And the stone was so much a personality to him that Jung would think of himself not only as sitting on the stone, but as of the stone thinking of Jung sitting upon it. Am I the one who's sitting on the stone, or am I the stone on which he is sitting? He asked himself. I could sit on it for hours, fascinated by the puzzle it set me. And it's very interesting that this image pursued him into the next development, where he began to feel and think of himself more and more as two distinct personalities. There was what he called the number one personality, the young boy who did what his parents wanted him to do, who went to school, who went to church, and who pretended to be a conventional Christian, however much he was haunted by this dream he had had of a great pagan god underground. But there was a number two personality. This number two personality, which increasingly took over Jung's imagination and was increasingly in conflict with the values of the number one personality, personified for Jung, I think, all the experience, as it were, of human life on earth. Because the image which came to him in connection with the number two personality was always that of somebody immeasurably older than himself. This number two personality lived, as it were, outside time. Like the stone, was indestructible, immemorial, from the far remote past. The play and counterplay between personalities number one and number two, he wrote, has run through my whole life. It is played out in every individual, and in my life, the number two personality has been of prime importance. He is a typical figure, but he is perceived only by very few. Most people's conscious understanding is not sufficient to realize that he is what they are. There was no doubt in the mind of the boy Jung that his number two personality had something to do with the creation of dreams. And as the authority of this image of a wise old man within himself grew, doubts about the attitude of his father, in particular his father's church, increased.
Whenever Jung took up points of dogmas with his father, as he did, for instance, with the doctrine of the Trinity, which excited him, his father wouldn't explain the points to him at all. His father made no sense to him. His father just said to him, "My boy, you think too much. You must just believe." And that was the point, vital point of departure. Jung felt all the time, no, it's the other way around. You must experience religion, and then know. And this is precisely what Jung questioned in the values of the Christian church of his day. The church seemed to him dead and meaningless, had ceased to live, had ceased to be a place of new monistic and living experience.
Jung's mother sympathized with these doubts. Out of her own intuition, she suggested that he read Faust, and in Goethe's drama of an intellect who makes a pact with the devil, the lonely boy found immediate comfort. At last he had confirmation that there were people who recognized the power of evil and the paradoxical role it could play in delivering man from darkness and suffering. In 1879, Jung's family had followed the Rhine to Basel, for 2,000 years Switzerland's nearest equivalent to a great seaport, and the city that was to give Jung his profound sense of history.
He was so poor that he had to walk along the banks of this great river Rhine from the vicarage in which his father was conducting his duties as a priest. And every day he came to the gymnasium at the back of this great cathedral. And one afternoon, when he was coming out of the gymnasium, he saw this cathedral under the most wonderful blue sky. And all that sense of well-being which he discovered as a child in the pram on the banks of the Rhine came back to him. And he thought, all's well. God's in this wonderful blue heaven on his golden throne. And as he got that far, a sort of choking sensation seized him, and he couldn't go any further. There was something else about God which he could not admit to himself. And almost in terror, he made for his home. And for the next 2 or 3 days, he lived in a state of terror, because what was this thing which he was thinking? This unbidden thing that had come to him. And it was only on the third night that he woke up in the middle of the night sweating. And there was still the fact that there was something in his imagination which he had not had the courage to face up to. And why? And why not? And at last he thought, well, this has come to me unbidden. This is God's will, that however terrible, I must think this thing about him. And I think one must just pause here and see what is to follow in the context of its day. Because remember, it wasn't this permissive age. This was 1887, when these sort of thoughts, even to oneself, were forbidden by convention. And the thing that he thought that he would not admit to himself was that an essential part of the vision that he had seen was that from his golden throne, God dropped some divine excrement on this cathedral to shatter it to pieces. I know it could easily sound very comic, but for taken symbolically, there was a deep meaning in this. It was as if the church itself, as Jung already suspected, in this unbidden vision, was shown to be something that had to be shattered, because it wasn't expressing the full and total wholeness of God, however disagreeable it might be to man.
Jung longed for his father and the whole Orthodox family to which he belonged to share the truth as he now knew it. For him, the relief of admitting this vision into his consciousness was so great that he accepted it as proof of the grace that comes to all men if they obey God's will. Religion was nothing if not obedience to awareness. In the setting of a rich city, Jung was painfully prized out of the natural world of his childhood. At school he was exceptionally able, and sometimes wrote such profound essays that his teachers wouldn't believe they were his own. University came as a liberation. Unable to study archaeology, he finally settled for medicine, but without relinquishing his deep interest in religion and philosophy. He impressed his professors as a medical student, and yet never lost his sense of the inadequacy of a purely scientific approach. In science, he wrote, "I miss the factor of meaning in religion, that of empiricism." He was aware increasingly of the conflict between the urban and the rural mind, aspects of life that had always been real, mysterious, and full of meaning to him were ignored or rejected by the academic world because they couldn't be explained or proved in the rational idiom of the moment. He realized that if ever the intellectual mind was to accept the promptings of the intuitive and the instinctive, it would have to be in the realm of facts. Even his own natural interest in psychic phenomena was put aside for this reason. As his university years came to an end, a textbook on psychiatry showed him the way he had to go. Suddenly, he knew that in the field of mental derangement, where the conflict between these two states of mind was most acute, could his interests unite. In the first year of this century, he joined the great Burghölzli Mental Hospital in Zurich as a psychiatrist. He locked himself up here in this institution for 6 months, working hard in the conventional way, trying to find out what it really did for mental patients. And the answer was nothing. And at the end of 6 months, he branched out in his own way. Increasingly, he found himself observing the attitudes of the doctors as much as those of the patients, because he already had a hunch that what passed for normality in life was perhaps the force which had shattered the personality of the patients in this institution. What actually takes place in the minds of the mentally ill? He asked himself. Why were psychiatrists not interested in what the patients themselves had to say? Why was the human personality, their individuality, ignored? How was he ever to establish contact? There was a famous case of Babette, a woman who was declared totally insane, who'd been in this hospital for 20 years, and the doctors had never listened to what she said. She would make a statement like, "Naples and I will have to supply the world with spaghetti in future." Well, the doctor said, "Well, you see how crazy she is," but to Jung, this was a form of compensation for the inferior way in which she was treating, and she herself inwardly was trying to put herself in a very important role. In the hallucinations and dreams of the patients, Jung found increasingly a new world of meaning. to describe this injured and rejected area of the human spirit, he used the word complex for the first time. And it's here that he came to the conclusion that every human being, every human personality had a story. And the derangement came when the story was denied or the story was rejected. And it was only in the discovery of the story, enabling the patient to rediscover his personal story, that the patient could be healed again. In 1903, Jung married Emma Rauschenbach, and they built a house together at Küsnacht, a few miles outside Zurich, on the edge of the Great Lake. In the years to come, his family helped to make this house a fortress of reality against all sorts of unknown forces clamoring for recognition in his imagination. Here he planted trees and was once again by the water, without which his natural self couldn't live. But there was something else very significant about this house. One starts off with Jung's life, with the sense that he had of the ultimate reality, the sense of what theologians call God, and that God was not forgotten. He's so very clearly shown by this inscription over the door, which says in Latin, called or not called, God shall be there. Jung's years of apprenticeship at the Burg Hölzli were drawing to a close. In 1909, Freud, the great pioneer of psychoanalysis, visited Jung at Küsnacht. They had met for the first time in Vienna 2 years earlier. Jung had been greatly helped by Freud's book on dream analysis, but from the start, there were areas of potential disagreement. Jung had already doubts about Freud's emphasis on sexuality as being at the root of all forms of man's unconscious troubles and difficulties. He thought there was a great deal more to it. You see, Jung fully went with Freud in Freud's attitude that the unconscious was the repository, as it were, of experiences that were too painful for the human being to admit consciously. No one disputed that Freud's major discovery was the existence of a personal unconscious, and that this was the area in which disturbances of the personality originated.
I liked him very much, but I soon discovered that when he had thought something, then it was settled. While I was doubting all along the line. And it was impossible to discuss something really a full. You know, he had no philosophical education, particularly I was studying Kant, and I was steeped in it. And that was far from Freud. So from the very beginning, there was a discrepancy.
Tell me, did Freud himself ever analyze you?
Yes, I submitted quite a lot of my dreams to him. And so did he.
And he to you, yes.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Do you remember now, at this distance of time, what were the significant features of Freud's dreams that you noted at the time?
Well, that is rather indiscreet to ask. You know, there is such a thing as a professional secret.
He's been dead these many years.
These regards last longer than life. I prefer not to talk about it.
In 1909, Freud and Jung were invited to lecture on their work at Clark University in America. And this was the first sign for these two lonely pioneers that the world might be prepared to listen to them. But in the unconscious of both men, the latent disagreement was gathering force. And the climax came in America.
when Freud told Jung a dream that he had had. And Jung said to Freud, well, look, if I'm to help you about this dream, there's one aspect of this dream which I can't interpret unless you tell me your personal associations with this aspect. And Freud, so Jung told me afterwards, blushed and said, I can't tell you this. And Jung said, why not? And Freud said, it's bad for my authority. And Jung says in that moment, something inside him snapped. And he knew that if a man cares more about authority than the truth, then he couldn't go on with him, because it was an essential part of his philosophy. It had been ever since he had been a boy, that man must not only think things, but he must also live them. And he felt that here there was a tremendous evasion at work. Jung had only to publish his Psychology of the Unconscious in 1912 for not only Freud but the whole of the psychological world to reject him. At the age of 37, he was once more out on his own. It was almost a repetition of the case mentioned in the Old Testament, where it was said, and Joseph had a dream and told his brethren, and they hated him for it. While the church-going Swiss went their normal way, Jung worked hard at everything normality rejected. Patients came in hundreds with their sense of injury and the dreams and visions that expressed it. Almost without exception, at the root of their sickness, he found a loss of faith. In every cure, some recovery of religious experience. He was confronted by an unconscious that went far deeper and stretched far wider than he or Freud had ever imagined. The impact was almost overwhelming. And one of the most intimate and personal ways in which he dealt with these new elements from the unconscious was the work he did in this red book, which is in front of me now. It's a very intimate, a very personal book. And as one faces it, one has almost the feeling one doesn't want to pry in it. But there are elements in it here which belong not only to Dr. Jung, but speak to all mankind, to every human being who has a problem with his unconscious. And the way in which the book begins expresses so beautifully already this immense reverence which he had for all forms of life, even the least known. Look how it begins. The language is an ancient language. It's written in an ancient script, and it's almost as if the number two personality whom we've met before is here guiding the handwriting. Here he first painted an intimation that the renewal of the soul has to flower in the unconscious, however frightening the forces that dwelt there. The cross of fulfillment in a burning circle, the core to wholeness. The forces of the unconscious are becoming accessible and finding meaningful forms. The fire of the self quickens and brings light to the unconscious. The last painting, a symbol of wholeness achieved. This then was his testament. But modern man is sick because he is not whole. Jung's future was clear, and the world was about to become his asylum. The mountains of Switzerland were always profoundly symbolic to Jung. He told me once that for him the modern age began when the poet Petrarch became the first man to climb a mountain in the Alps. For Jung it was a sure sign that the age of medieval introspection had ended. From that moment, European man started to look at the outer world with new eyes. I can say that for me, a new phase of the life of our time began when Jung climbed the mountains and explored the valleys of the unconscious within modern man. He realized how much we had lost by neglecting our inner world, how dangerously one-sided we had become in ignoring our intuitive and instinctive selves. By the age of 40, Jung's reputation as a psychiatrist was secure. He lived with his wife and five children on Lake Zurich. His 9 years of work with mental patients and 15 years of private practice had given him many of the facts he needed for understanding the conflicts in modern man, exemplified by the clash between science and religion. The charge of mysticism hurled at Jung in this period was so particularly unfair, because in everything he'd been doing, he'd been showing the traditional thoroughness, as it were, of a Swiss watchmaker putting a very delicate and infinitely complex timepiece together. He told me, for instance, that in this period, before he uttered another word about dreams, he worked through 67,000 dreams with his own patients. That's an idea of his thoroughness. But Jung felt that he couldn't move on to understand conflict in others until he understood fully what had caused his own differences with Freud. Ostensibly, they had parted company over Freud's insistence that sexuality was at the root of all man's conflicts and strivings. There was also Freud's own quarrel with his collaborator, Adler, who was explaining everything in terms of an urge to power.
He often said, "I know many people for whom a Freudian psychology is right, for others whom an Adlerian psychology is right, but neither express the whole man. Both are forms of one-sidedness. What constitutes the whole man? What is the secret of the whole personality?" This became the driving aim of his life. But me in examining the origins of the parting of ways with Freud, he suddenly realized, "I'm up against type, a fundamental inbuilt psychology of type, which varies in men." And he coined two new words, or rather used two old words in a new way to explain it. He suddenly realized that Freud was an extrovert and Adler was an introvert. And what is more,
he found that within the framework of the extrovert and the introverted personality, there were differences of psychological functions. He came to the conclusion that each human being had four functions, and that one of these functions always tended to be superior and specialized, and another function, also conscious, aided and abetted the superior function, and the remaining two tended to be pushed underground. And there were obvious infinite numbers of combinations between these functions. I don't think it's important to analyze these functions and give them their names. But as a result of this, he wrote and formulated his conclusions in a book called The Psychology of Type, or The Theory of Individuation, this new word, which became the ultimate goal of his seeking. Individuation meaning that each human being had a specific nature and a calling which was peculiarly his own. And unless he fulfilled this calling in a non-one-sided way, unless he fulfilled this calling in such a way that the specialized superior functions were joined by the repressed unconscious functions sometime in life, and the man made a whole, man became sick. As the tribes in Africa used to say, man lost his soul. Or to use a word which I prefer, the psyche. And the psyche for him was this great objective world within, which he discovered and which he was going to explore now in order to find the wholeness of man. He had all the material available. And for him, this world within was just as great as the universe without. He often said to me, when you look inside yourself, you see the universe and all its stars and all their infinity objectively spread out, and you fall away into an infinite mystery, an infinite objective mystery within yourself, as great as the one without. Now, his psychology of types in this regard was extremely important, because it explained so much of why philosophers were always quarreling with one another, why scientists were quarreling with priests. But they didn't know that they were really after the same things in their different ways. And I personally think that this book of his, this work of his on the psychology of types, was of immense importance to mankind, difficult as it is, because for the first time it gives human beings who are constitutionally, psychologically different a chance of talking a common language, and not, as Anatole France once said, kill one another over the meaning of words, whereas if they'd understood what the words were trying to say, they would have embraced one another. Jung gave, through the psychology of types, the modern world a contemporary way in which all men could speak a common language. And from that moment, he felt free of Freud. He felt free of the past. He felt free to go all out to explore the objective psyche, because already he was convinced it was through centuries of one-sided neglect of the whole of the psyche that modern man was ill, that he was even more sick in his normality than he was sick in the asylums, that he was, as it were, a man in search of his soul, in search of his psyche. Until he found the way to that, he would never be well. The churches of the day were beginning to empty. In his consulting room, Jung saw the consequences of this loss of faith. But however much those who still clung to their churches rejected the neurotic, Jung had become convinced that within a neurosis were the seeds of new growth. He had come to know this with certainty because, unlike the psychiatrist of his day, he didn't set himself apart from his patients. The doctor is effective, he wrote, only when he himself is affected. Only the wounded physician heals. He had established empirically that dreams were a code of precious objective facts, informing the dreamer of his greater potential. He found that the moment he helped a patient to discover meaning in his neurosis, it was transformed into a source of positive energy. It was an indication of what St. Paul called the priesthood of the suffering, and that in this individual suffering, there was a sense of what was inadequate in the attitude of a whole culture, of a whole civilization. And the last thing in the world, I think, that Jung wanted to do was really to remove people's sense of maladjustment. Of course, he wanted them to accept their social reality as he accepted his. But he didn't want to remove from them their sense that the life of their time was hopelessly inadequate, because this is one of the most valuable things that the human being has. Tension. That's why the use of drugs are so wrong. That they try to remove the sense of tension inside the human being, which is the most valuable thing he has, to show him that his time is wrong and that he and his whole society needs changing. Yet professionally, more isolated than ever, Jung had to look within for support. He had always felt that he had not only a number one personality who met the demands of society, but also a number two. In time, the number two personality of Jung assumed such definite proportions, such a clarity, that he could actually paint and draw it. And then, of course, seeing the drawing, one realizes immediately that this was a personification of one of the great archetypes, the archetype of the wise old man, the thing within all human beings which has a knowledge, a potentiality of all the life that has ever been and perhaps ever could be. Jung called this figure Philemon. We all have a Philemon within ourselves, whether we know it or not. Most of us don't realize it, because we find our Philemons in wise men and leaders in the world outside. In my fantasies, I held conversations with Philemon, Jung wrote. Philemon said, I treated thoughts as if I generated them myself. But in his views, thoughts were like animals in the forest or birds in the air, and added, if you should see people in a room, you wouldn't think that you had made those people. It was he who taught me psychic objectivity. It was precisely in order to promote this dialogue with his Philemon self that Jung sought the peace of a natural setting for a new kind of home at Bonningen. Gradually, through my scientific work, he wrote, I was able to put my fantasies and the contents of the unconscious on a solid footing. Words and paper, however, didn't seem real enough to me. Something more was needed. I had to achieve a kind of representation in stone of my innermost thoughts and of the knowledge I had acquired. Or to put it another way, I had to make a confession of faith in stone. That was the beginning of the tower, the house which I built at Bonningen. Kisnacht was Jung's fortress. And this place in which I'm sitting was his own sanctuary. At Kisnacht, Jung had his fortress in the world. He did. He was functioning. He was active. Here in his sanctuary, Jung had his being.
he was. He belonged, as it were, outside time. And he lived here extremely simply. He had no telephone. He had no electricity. It was a sort of place to which a man from the 16th century could come and feel completely at home. And it was wonderful to see him here making a fire and cooking. He was the most wonderful cook that I've ever met. And I don't think he worked really from a given recipe so much. He would have an idea in his mind, but he would invent the things as he went along. He took infinite pains about it. Jung surrounded his tower with trees. From childhood, trees had made him feel close to the deepest meaning of life. They expressed for him not only the beauty, but also the thoughts of God. Said, and he said so in public, that one of the troubles with modern man was that modern man had forgotten how to live the symbols in himself, how he'd forgotten to live the symbolic life, and how, for instance, he had found that even in the poorest house in India, there was always a tiny little corner which was regarded as private and sacred, to which the personality could withdraw, and where it could be at one with life and the universe. And this he lived out here himself. This intuition is enshrined in the last section of the house he built on top. It was a room in which he felt he could contemplate and commune with his number two personality, where he could commune with a nature which had always meant so much to him, and where he could be his timeless self. The dialogue he had begun with Stone as a lonely boy on the banks of the Rhine, here at Bollingen, took on concrete form. The dream figures, the symbols, the mythological motives, which he had brought back from his exploration of the unconscious, he carved into the foundation of his tower. Here was striking evidence of a revolutionary new approach to dreams. Freud's attitude to dreams had been that he, and his theory, knew what the dreams were about. Jung's attitude was that in the first place, the dream was the personal possession of everybody who dreamed it. So the dream spoke a private language and a personal language, and it was a key to that particular individual's responsibility to his own unconscious dynamic, which he had not yet learned to respect and to bring into proper relationship with his conscious self. But deeper than that, there was a kind of dream which he had recognized first in the most unbalanced of his patients, but had then found in his ordinary patients, and then found particularly in his own visions. These were dreams that belonged to the whole of mankind, and they came from a level which Jung called the collective unconscious. Jung was satisfied that his dream as a child of a phallic divinity came from the underground of this collective unconscious. But he knew that one such dream was not enough to prove the validity of so revolutionary a concept. He set out to travel the world for further proof. By 1926, he was in the jungle, in the heart of Africa.
Already he'd been among the Negroes and the Indians of North America. He'd been to North Africa and gone deeply into the mythological development of India, Tibet, China, and Japan. Now, as he approached Mount Elgon in the Great Rift Valley, everything he had found up to then confirmed his concept of the collective unconscious, that no matter what the race, the personality, or the culture, here was the level where all men were one, with access to forces of infinite growth, forces that revealed themselves in exactly the same symbols throughout the world. He hadn't come across a single myth, legend, religion, or dream which did not contain identical symbols. Now, as he lived among the people of Elgon, the new evidence was overwhelming. He told me, for instance, that their witch doctor drew the same distinction between dreams as he did, dividing them into personal and great dreams, equivalent to his own distinction between the dream from the personal unconscious and the dream from the collective unconscious. And from Elgon, he set off towards the Nile, perhaps the greatest mythological river in history. Of all Jung's journeys, his trip to Africa made the most profound impression on him. In his old age, he wrote to me, "I shall never cease to thank the fates that wove the pattern of my life, that they included the experience of Africa and all its wonder." As he journeyed down the Nile back to the modern world, he felt more than ever that European man had a forgotten, primitive, myth-making man within him. It was the loss of contact with this instinctive self, this rural mind, as he had called it as a student, which had caused modern man's own myth, the great myth of Christianity, to lose its power of renewal. The task of bringing out of the unconscious this neglected primitive within us, and of making it an honored partner of our conscious selves, seemed to him the only way to wholeness, the only way to healing the sickness of our time. But the last thing you wanted as he traveled among the ruins of the great civilization of Egypt was to see the Western world vanish likewise. The more he had traveled, the more he valued his own cultural inheritance. One of his last memories of Africa was that of a snake heraldic in the sun. The snake which in the world of primitive man, as well as in the ancient world of Greece, was the symbol of everlasting renewal and healing. Though Jung's world might be sick, he was convinced that it was great enough to achieve renewal. He was going home determined to dedicate himself more than ever to the task of healing. At Küsnacht, Jung began to enlarge and deepen his research. In all forms of personal and cultural derangement, he found a break of continuity between past and present. His reading of the neglected areas of history and philosophy gave him a new insight into how that loss of continuity had come about in European man. He saw, for instance, how Christianity had maimed itself by cutting out the work of the Gnostics, who had tried to revitalize narrow dogma with their own living experience of religion. He recognized the despised alchemists as pioneers in his own field. His reading confirmed his notion of constant and recurring patterns and motives in the spirit of man, primordial images which he called archetypes. Two of the greatest of these he named anima and animus, the feminine in man and the masculine in woman. The animus is the creative self in woman. As in the case of Emma Jung and her book on the Holy Grail, It leads woman to a creative role beyond that of being a mother. But for Jung, a man in a world dominated by men, the neglected feminine motive, the anima, was crucial. The anima is one of the greatest of the archetypes, because it is a personification, as it were, of all the feminine values of life, which is so necessary for man to be his full creative self. One can think of these many examples of this personification of this great archetype in the history of man. Venus, Persephone, Ariadne, and much nearer to our own time, as part of the great reawakening of the European spirit in the Renaissance, as the Beatrice who led Dante down into the depths of hell and up again into the heights of heaven. And very early on, Jung had an intimation of the existence of this personification of the anima, of this imagery of the anima, which appeared in his own dreams and in his own life. And he realized its importance as a great reconciling factor between the split of conscious man from his unconscious self, that this too was a built-in pattern in the spirit of every man that could take and lead him down into the depths of his unknown self, if properly understood, and bring him up again into his conscious self with a greater form of awareness than he had before. The first charting of the unknown sea of man's unconscious here in Zurich was carried as far as Jung for the moment could carry it. He now felt free to turn to the problems of what he called the last quarter of life. Where does man stand in the scheme of things? What is his responsibility to the universe and time? Reality and events seen merely as a chain of pure cause and effect made no sense to him. He felt convinced that one of the misfortunes of Western thinking was precisely this view of looking at our history and looking at our future in terms of mere cause and effect. He was convinced that somewhere there was another principle at work. And this too came to him from intimations of his own unconscious self. And these things were manifested to him particularly through the way in which in dreams, sometimes, the way one couldn't explain, the future would be foretold when there was no cause, as yet even, to cause that particular future. It came to him through what we were inclined to dismiss as mere coincidence. And through his linking up with the ancient Chinese way of thinking, his own concept of this other principle became clearer, and he was convinced that this was due to modern man's misconception of the nature of time. Modern man saw time purely as a measure. Jung thought there was something far more to time than that. He was already impressed by the role in which the conscious, unconscious, collective unconscious in particular, transcended time, seemed to be beyond time. And he was impressed more and more by the fact that time had a nature and character of its own, and that out of the nature and character of its own, it contribute to the nature and character of life on Earth. But the important thing of seeing life a-causally, that is, not in terms of cause and effect,
is that it's an immense act of psychological emancipation, because it frees man from this dreadful feeling which scientific specialists have implanted in modern man, that he's a slave of cause and effect, that if something is done to him at a certain point, he's almost forced to react to it in a predetermined way. But this shows that man, in cooperation with time, can use what the scientist up to now calls a cause as the base material, as the alchemist used base matter. And he has a freedom of choice to use it in a creative way and to turn it into something completely new. For Jung too, the completion of this concept was an act of liberation, a liberation from the demands of the here and now he had served so well. He felt free to turn his imagination more to death and beyond. Here, in 1933, a completely new phase in the life of Jung began. At last, he was ready. He had the facts. This instinct which he had as a young student at Bale University, not to talk out of his feelings anymore, but to talk out of facts. He had gained all the experience he needed at the Burghölzi. He'd gone out into the world, he'd gained the experience from private patients, he'd done an immense amount of research into history, and he was ready now to talk to the world, no longer to a privileged set of patients and people who believed in him. And on this spot, on the shores of Lake Maggiore, in the Casa Gabriella, he found the perfect platform to speak on. Here a remarkable Dutch woman called Olga Fröbe-Kaptein had started a sort of platonic philosophic group where scholars from all over the world came to talk on a common theme for about 10 days. They lived together and people came from all over Europe and the world to listen to them. But somehow always to her it seemed a voice, a really important voice was missing. And in 1932, she went to see Jung in Zurich. And he agreed to come and talk. And one of the most interesting things about this establishment at Erenos was that for the 10 days or 12 days through which it took place, people met and gathered after lectures in particular places to talk. But the favorite place of talking was over here at this wonderful round table, which you see here. This is exactly the table as it was when Jung first knew it, and as I knew it when I spoke here myself.
people would come and sit round this table and they would talk. Now the round table meant a great deal to Jung, as it means a great deal in human thinking, because it is a symbol of wholeness. And people sitting round a round table were partaking together of the food of wholeness. They were becoming whole in the principle. Jung was now 58. The imposing number of his books and essays showed how the long years of work as a psychiatrist and interpreter of human dreams and myths had given him a unique vantage point for surveying the problems of his time. Here at Eranos, no matter what aspect of his work they discussed, all ultimately was concerned with the concept of wholeness. And never before had the integrity of European man been in greater danger. In Germany and Italy, the terrifying spectacle of the Nazi and fascist hordes was there to remind them all of what happens when men fail to digest the bitter ingredient of their despised and rejected selves. Jung had a simple word to describe this ingredient. He called it the shadow. He had already worked through his own area of neglect and faced the problem it presented so honestly that he actually painted this portrait of the shadow within the basement of his own unconscious. Bringing the individual to face his shadow is a major task of the Jungian analyst. Dr. Meyer was Jung's closest collaborator in those fateful years, and now holds his old professorship of psychology in Zurich.
If you use the term shadow, of course, you speak of something that is shown in certain dream images, for instance, which always represents a hated figure or a despised of person or an enemy or something, or somebody who is adverse to you, hostile to you. And we then try, if these figures turn up in dreams, we try to see what are the qualities, the characteristics of that figure. And in this way, we begin to learn that these are qualities within ourselves, which theoretically go back to the inferior function, which we always despise within ourselves. You always have somebody whom you particularly dislike, and he probably has all the qualities you dislike within yourself, only you project them on this person, unconsciously this is done. I mean, it's a mechanism that happens automatically, always. Now, we have to understand that this is the, shall we say, Dr. Jekyll or the Mr. Hyde in you, and we must come to terms with that quality before we can make peace with the world. Otherwise, we always have a scapegoat somewhere.
This is what I think very important. I wanted to ask you, the individual who comes to terms with his shadow, who pulls it away from his neighbor and accepts it as a personal problem within himself, in your view, does a task which is of world and universal importance?
Indeed. The worst effects of all this projection mechanism, of course, are in the great masses, like the famous projection of the shadow, of the German shadow on the Jews when they were on Nazi condition, etc. I mean, then it begins to be absolutely destructive and dangerous for the whole rest of the world under certain conditions. That is where it begins to show on a collective level.
I know, Professor Meyer, you have studied healing in the ancient pagan world of Greece, and that you wrote somewhere that healing was always a mystery. Would you say that Jungian psychology is a process of bringing modern man back to the mystery that heals?
I would very definitely say so, for the reason that the
shall we say, the process of healing is ununderstood. Even in the very trivial case of a broken leg or something, you see, remains a mystery in terms of natural science. We know all kinds of things as what is going on with the consolidation of a fractured bone, for instance, but essentially we cannot understand it. And I would say that this is even more so in the realm of psychology, where we depend entirely on factors which we don't seem to be able to control. What we can do is to, shall we say, render the patient open to make him accessible to those things that go on. And he can, of course, behave wrongly or rightly or more appropriate, so that it is more conducive to these things taking place, but as such we cannot make them take place technically speaking. We depend on their happening, and all we can do is to prepare the ground for the happening of these shall we say processes that are conducive to healing. And this is, in a way, as you can easily see, a, shall we say, a religious attitude you have to establish.
No, he was a deeply religious man, perhaps the most religious man I ever knew, but he belongs certainly to the great religious personality of our age, I should say. This one can understand from different points of view. Not only gave he new interpretations to old dogmas, for instance, he felt very much to be a Christian, but to his feeling, Christianity nowadays needs renewal.
Aniela Jaffe was a refugee from Hitler's Germany and became Jung's secretary and biographer.
Many men today can no longer believe, only simply believe. They are not able to believe, they are not simple enough. And to them, he explained what Christianity really means from a symbolic standpoint. One can say that is a, in the history of religion, a very great deed. For him, the psyche was as much a mystery as matter for the physicist. One does not know what the psyche is, really. There is no definition. One doesn't know. One knows it's working. But if you ask a physicist what is matter, you come also to the same mystery. And that is, perhaps I may add this, one of the great signs of greatness of Jung, to my feeling, was that he always admitted when he came to the bounds of his knowledge. For him, life was a great mystery. And what we know of life and what we understand was only very little. Anyhow, his longing for understanding was enormous. He was learning and trying to understand all his life, but he never hesitated to say, I don't know. Anything which is coming up from the unconscious is ambiguous. It is a paradox. It is the one and the other. And the great danger of consciousness is to be one-sided. And Jung's great concern was to see things on both sides. You see, why does the shadow come up? Because we think that we are good and right, and we do the right things and so on. And then the backside of the coin is the shadow. But, for instance, if you are If you are consciously in the shadow, in the darkness, for instance, and you you have no longer a belief in yourself, you find you are the most, the weakest person, and then comes from the unconscious the light side. It's always compensating the conscious side, and there is a tendency to a balance, even to a paradox. You cannot understand the world if you don't understand the paradox.
Jung found himself turning more and more towards his sanctuary among the trees, by the water at Bonningen. His whole life had been a dialogue with the sick, a dialogue with his own unconscious, a dialogue with the whole history of man, and only here did he have the inner silence for the final dialogue. From Bollingen he wrote to me, "I cannot define for you what God is, but I can tell you that my work has proved that the pattern of God exists in every man." "I am an increasingly lonely old man," he told me, "a writing for other lonely old men." "This is old age and a limitation," he wrote. "Yet there is so much that fills me, plants, animals, clouds, day and night, and the eternal in man. The more uncertain I have felt about myself, the more there has grown up in me a feeling of kinship with all things." In 1955, his wife Emma died, her great work on the Holy Grail almost complete. Jung designed and carved a memorial in stone. I remember him saying to me, "Follow the feeling of what happens after death. That has most meaning for you, that gives most meaning. Trust the meaning, trust that which gives you meaning, and accept it as your guide."
You have written at one time and another some sentences which have surprised me a little about death. Now, in particular, I remember you've said that death is psychologically just as important as birth. And like it, it's an integral part of life. But surely it can't be like birth if it's an end, can it?
Yes, if it's an end. And there we are not quite certain about this end. Because, you know, there are these peculiar faculties of the psyche that it isn't entirely confined to space and time. You can have dreams or visions of the future. You can see round corners and such things. Only ignorance deny these facts. It's quite evident that they do exist and have existed always. Now these facts show that the psyche, in part at least, is not dependent upon these confinements. And then what? When the psyche is not under that obligation to live in time and space alone, and obviously it doesn't, then to that extent the psyche is not submitted to those laws. And that means a practical continuation of life, of a sort of psychical existence beyond time and space.
Now, when his wife, who meant so much to him, died, I wrote a letter to him about it, and he wrote a wonderful letter back, but with a phrase in it which made my heart go black all over, about how he now was faced with a silence from which there was no answer. Because in a sense, it seemed to me as if he'd forgotten this message of following what had the most meaning for one. And then some months later, I got a letter from him. He'd remembered this. And he said to me, "I'm glad to tell you that it isn't silent. The silence has been broken. It's been broken by a dream. I had a dream in which I entered a very dark theater. And there the stage was brilliantly lit. And I walked down this dark and hushed theater, and I came to the gulf of an orchestra, a bit like an abyss, which made it impossible for me to go to the stage. But in the center of the stage, more beautiful than I've ever seen, sat my wife." And he refers not in detail to this dream, but he refers to the dream itself in his autobiography. And he talks of it as how he had received from the other side, as it were, a portrait of his wife that might have been commissioned personally for him by his wife. This was the dream.
Well, now, you told us that we should regard death as being a goal.
Yes.
And that to shrink away from it is to evade life and
yes.
live life purposes.
Yes.
What advice would you give to people in their later life to enable them to do this, when most of them must in fact believe that death is the end of everything? Mm-hmm.
Well, you see, I have treated many old people, and it's quite interesting to watch what the unconscious is doing with the fact that it is apparently threatened with a complete end. It disregards it. Life behaves as if it were going on. And so I think it is better for old people to live on, to look forward to the next day, as if he had to spend centuries, and then he lives properly.
He was said that he was not understood, and this was not a vanity, this was not for himself, but he feared that the future of mankind there was a great danger, and the only solution he saw in order to escape from this danger was to become more conscious. As soon as there is a mass psychology, too many people, there's a danger, because in the mass, the single member of the mass has no responsibility. One has a responsibility more if one is one single individual.
We need more understanding of human nature, because the only real danger that exists is man himself. He is the great danger, and we are pitifully unaware of it. We know nothing of man, far too little. His psyche should be studied, because we are the origin of all coming evil.
At the same time, he could enjoy life up to the last moment, especially nature. When he was in Bollingen, he felt quite happy, especially in silence, when he didn't speak, when he remained silent. Then he felt as a part of nature, a part of the lake, a part of the woods, and this gave him rest and gave him trust.
He was a man, from the time I knew him to the end, bursting with vitality. I'd not known anybody in my life, of the many interesting people I've met, who made me laugh as much as he made me laugh. It's remarkable that filled with these immense energies, that he couldn't contain them with such great good humor. But he realized also the importance of being not only ruthless with himself, but to a certain extent ruthless with the people whom he wanted to help. And that the only way he could help them was not to let himself be dissolved into a kind of woolly sentimentality. One of the most important things Jung ever uttered, and which is a clue to this, was a statement that he made about the life of Christ. He said that it was a great error for the human being to imitate the example of Christ blindly and to live as if the individual were just a copy, a blueprint of Christ himself. The real essence, the real meaning of Christ for Jung, the meaning he wanted to pass on to all of us, was that it was the task of man to live the unique individual self he had been born, as truly as Christ had lived the end for which he was born. I saw Jung alive for the last time in this room. I was on my way to Africa, and as usual, I dropped off on the way to see him. And he excused himself for not getting up and not for speaking to me at once, and pointed to a very old leather-bound copy of a book he had in his hand. And he said, "This is a copy of a work by Erasmus in Latin, which I bought as a boy of 19 in Basel." To my amazement, he was reading it as I would read English, as fast as anything. And he was well over 80 then, without difficulty. And he said, "I'm reading it because I've got a guest staying with me who's very interested in the words carved over the entrance to my house." He said, "Of course I know that comes from the Greeks, but there's a reference to it in Erasmus, and I want the reference, and I'm tracing it down." And this is my final vision of him, because in this fortress that he made of his home, in this place in which he achieved his own wholeness, he entered it with a thought that, called or not called, consciously or unconsciously, God is always there. And this thought was with him to the end. This is the thought with which he started as a child in life. This is the thought which he tried to make modern. This is the task of man always, is not to eliminate the ancient truths, the ancient intimations of the unconscious, the ancient intimations of the soul, but is to make them immediate and contemporary, to give them a meaning in the here and now. On the afternoon of June the 6th, 1961, the sky suddenly darkened over the lake at Küsnacht. Coincidence for Jung had always been full of meaning. Just over 10 years ago, almost to a day, Dr. Jung died in this house. Then, as now, It seemed as if nature recognized the event. A great thunderstorm swept over Zurich. Lightning crashed and destroyed one of his favorite trees in the garden just over here where he used to sit. And it was symbolically in the unconscious of hundreds of people who'd known him and read him, as if a great ship had gone down and dragged towards it, like flotsam and jetsam on the sea, all sorts of strange dreams and portents to accompany the event. But what was even more significant was the fact that 3 days before he died, Dr. Jung had been quite well, had perhaps the last of the dreams that could be communicated to men. He had just finished his last written work, a work on symbols. And the dream came to him, the first of which said, showed him high up in a high place, a round boulder, a great boulder of stone. And on this stone was inscribed the words, "Take this as a symbol of your wholeness and the singleness you've become." And the same night he dreamt another dream. He dreamt that he saw in a square, the square that was also a symbol of wholeness, trees arising and growing, and the roots coming up above the ground. And the roots were intertwined with gold, the symbol of resolution, the alchemical symbol of wholeness. The collective unconscious was saying to him, as it were, "You've done your work, and you've done it well."